Hello, and welcome to my film, which covers a typical six-week voyage to the Mediterranean by cargo ship in the early 1960s. Firstly, let me fill in a bit of background. In the early 60s, air transport had yet to develop properly, so everything, from the smallest box of pins to the largest locomotive, had to be transported by sea. And at this time, the British merchant fleet was still the largest in the world. Containers had not yet been introduced, and apart from specialist ships, such as tankers, all cargo was carried in what were known as general cargo ships. These were operated by a large number of independent shipping companies, some with very long histories, often trading on specific routes, and offering scheduled services. Some examples of famous names now consigned to history are Blue Star Line, which served Australia and New Zealand, Ellerman Lines, serving the Mediterranean and Near East, British India, which once had one of the largest fleets in the world, serving India and the Far East, and Union Castle, which scheduled services to South Africa. Others, such as P&O, Bibby Lines, and Furnace Lines, adapted and diversified, and survived to the present day. The ships obviously varied in size, and usually had four or five holds, in which the cargo was stowed in order of the ports to be visited, the lowest tier usually being that destined for the furthest port. Each hold would have a set of cranes called derricks, which enabled cargo handling to be done even if the ship was at anchor. Each hold would also have one or more upper levels, called tween decks, used for lighter cargoes and which made cargo distribution easier. Here, there were often compartments for refrigerated cargo or lock-ups for high-value goods. Hatch covers were provided at each level to give us a clear deck to work on. Many ships could also carry up to 12 passengers, the maximum number allowed without a doctor being carried. If they booked for the whole trip, there was always an additional bit of excitement, since the ship's itinerary could be varied, even during the voyage, resulting in an unexpected port of call. Our ship is called the Scottish Prince, a small motor vessel of 3,364 tons, launched in 1950. She and her sister ships were used by Furnace Withy and Prince Lines to cover the Mediterranean trade. The outbound cargo was of immense variety, while during the right season, citrus fruit, carobs and nuts would form a major part of what we brought back. This film was made in 1964, when I was her third navigating officer, having sailed in her previously as a deck cadet. In this film, we'll visit Tunis, Tripoli in Libya, Alexandria in Egypt, Beirut in Lebanon, Latakia in Syria, and then Cyprus and Malta on the way home. So, let's now get underway. We've left the UK, crossed the Bay of Biscay, and made our way down the west coast of Spain to its southwestern corner, which is known as Cape St. Vincent, and which will make an excellent starting point for our film. Perched on top of these rugged cliffs, the lighthouse can be seen for miles, and thus provides a very welcome beacon for ships approaching Europe from all over the world. The cliffs are barren, and very steep too, which does enable us to get quite close inshore and to have a good look at them. Sometimes, if conditions are right, the cliffs can create some spectacular spray effects. As you can see, the cliffs are very extensive. From here we will head down to the Straits of Gibraltar, enjoying a nice peaceful sea and a bit of company as well. During the night, we've passed through the Straits and into the Mediterranean, and are now heading east along the north shore of Africa towards our first port of call, Tunis. Here we're at the front of the ship, on the forecastle, looking aft towards the stern, with the foremast in front of us. The windows of the bridge are visible behind the mast, and the wooden section above the bridge is called the Monkey Island. Either side of the bridge, you can see small masts called Samson posts, which carry the after derricks for number 2 hold. As you can see, we do like to keep the ship looking nice if we can. However, the weather has turned against us, with the wind up to force 6, known as a strong breeze on the Beaufort scale. Although it may seem rough, we would actually call this only a moderate sea, since the wind speed is only halfway up the scale, which peaks at hurricane force 12. Since we don't have an autopilot, the helmsman must keep to our course, using the gyro compass in the grey box which you can just see to the left. In front of him is the brass binnacle, which houses the magnetic compass. You may be unfamiliar with the difference between the two types. The magnetic compass uses the Earth's magnetic field, but does not point to true north, the angle between the two directions being called variation. Since this alters across the globe and from year to year, it makes navigation a little tricky. On the other hand, the gyro compass is a stabilized mechanical device which always points to true north. We're now passing the Algerian port of Beaune, which we do sometimes visit, on our final run-in towards Tunis. Tunis City lies at the southern end of the large Gulf of Tunis. The port itself is inland, and is reached through a 6-mile-long canal across a large lake, unsurprisingly called Lac de Tunis. The lake is very shallow and covers an area of 37 square kilometres, or 14 square miles, and it's been an important feature of the area since its earliest history. Tunis is the capital city of Tunisia, which was a French protectorate until 1956, and still maintains close ties with France. The ruins of the ancient city of Carthage are found nearby on the coast, and following the Roman occupation of the area, Tunisia became Rome's breadbasket for nearly 800 years. Evidence of the Roman occupation is everywhere. Here we're looking down into number 3 hold, and you can see the cargo stowed in the tween deck, as we unload a new Land Rover for a customer. We're using one of the ship's derricks to carry out the operation. Our incoming cargo would often include cars and tractors, as well as engines in crates. Tobacco and textiles were also very popular items. As we look across the dockside, it's interesting to note that everything you see stored here would now be carried in containers, and we would certainly not be able to wander around investigating and being nosy. Now that we've finished our cargo work here, it's time to leave and move on. So we're back in the canal heading out to sea. Ahead in the distance is the harbour of La Goulette, marking the seaward end. We have to maintain a slow speed due to the heavy wash that we create as we pass. Amazingly, the northern bank of the canal, which you see here, which carries the main road and railway from La Goulette to Tunis, was originally built by the Romans and was then incorporated by the French when they built the canal in the 19th century. However, the increasing size of modern ships means that they cannot use the canal, so Tunis Port is no longer in use. As we approach La Goulette, There's just time for a last view across the northern shore of the lake. Historically, La Villette town has had an important military function, guarding the access to Tunis, and its 16th century fort, built on top of the ancient Roman ruins and known as the Caracca, still stands today. Now, however, the harbour is used mainly for cruise ships and fishing, and the town itself is a popular destination for its beach and its fish restaurants, and the main cargo port for Tunis now being Rodez, to the south of the canal entrance. Well, let's now move on to our next destination, Tripoli in Libya. We leave the Gulf of Tunis and shape our course to the southeast for a voyage which will last us about a day. We're rounding the forbidding headland of Cape Bon, which marks the northeastern tip of Tunisia, and this is the area where the Africa Corps finally surrendered to the Allies in World War II in May 1943. We're underway now, and the second mate has the watch. He's checking the radar for traffic and for our position. For the Merchant Navy at this time, radar was still a relatively new toy, and many captains were still suspicious of its use, feeling it might reduce awareness by the bridge staff. Although our radar was very primitive by modern standards, it was very useful both for navigation and for avoiding collisions, and radar has of course become completely essential today. As one of our passengers takes the air on the boat deck, I can use this section of our trip to introduce you to another aspect of our cargo handling, the carriage of live animals. This was an essential service and often involved exotic animals destined for zoo collections. Here you can see some specially made accommodation in which are housed our guests on this trip, a nucleus herd of Frisian cattle destined for a farm in Libya. As you can see, they each occupy their own cabin in the block, with the two bulls being housed in individual crates for easier unloading. All of them are looked after by their own staff, who accompany them to Tripoli. Most larger animals would be carried on deck, and usually aft of the central accommodation and facing inward, as these are, to protect them from incoming spray. The travelling crates would be specially made to fit the particular ship and were not normally reused. Any type of animal always became a centre of attention, and these guys were soon great favourites with everyone on board. Okay, we've finished our run down the coast, and here we are, now approaching Tripoli Harbour. Tripoli is the capital of Libya and its largest city. It was originally founded by the Phoenicians in the 7th century BC, and there are many significant archaeological sites to be found. By 1934, Libya had become a colony of Italy and remained controlled by them until the Allies took over in 1943 during World War II. It was then governed by the British till it became independent in 1951. In 1986, Tripoli was heavily bombed by the Americans, and in 2011 was further greatly damaged during the Libyan Civil War. Although our visit this time was mainly to deliver the herd, our cargo for Libya often included cars and trucks, and sugar and soap products were very popular items. We often also brought timber as a deck cargo. Most of what we loaded here to take away would be personal effects, with some textiles. At the time of this visit, Libya was still in the early stages of developing its oil reserves, which today make up nearly 90% of its exports. Sadly, our friends are now leaving us for pastures new, and again we're using our derricks for the unloading. All our good wishes go with them in their future home. Although these two seem nice and peaceful, I really don't think I would choose that position to stand on the lorry. With the unloading completed and everything battened down, Alexandria and Egypt is next on our schedule. So off we go. On this leg, I thought you might like to see a little of what the seamen do while we're at sea, if conditions allow. Cleaning and painting forms the bulk of the work, and it obviously makes sense to start at the top and work down. We can tell that this is the aftermast, since it's painted black at the top, where the funnel gases blow past. A bit of clowning always helps the day along, and these seamen are engaged in sujiing, which is our name for washing the paintwork. Obviously, all the external surfaces get covered in salt, which must be removed before painting. Some of us, however, relax before their work starts. Working aloft needs planning, since you can't easily nip down for something you've forgotten. Here, the men are using bosun's chairs to reach the mast structures. These resemble an old-fashioned wooden seat for a swing. This would be suspended on a rope, running through a pulley above the occupant. Having climbed into the seat, the man would pass the loose part of the rope round his body and secure it in front of himself, using a special knot which will enable him to lower himself under perfect control. Having removed all the salt, painting can now get underway in earnest. And the accommodation, of course, presents a much easier job. We've picked up a hitchhiker en route, and you can see that pigeons get everywhere. He does try a little bit of exercise, but obviously finds riding the waves a much easier option. The voyage from Tripoli to Alexandria takes us about 2.5 days in good weather, and we're now approaching the harbour. Alexandria, universally known in the British services as Alex, is Egypt's second largest city and a major economic centre for the country. It's one of the oldest known ports in the world, having been founded as far back as 331 BC, and it was the site for one of the seven wonders of the ancient world, the Pharos Lighthouse. Its turbulent history spans the Greek civilization, followed by the Romans, until the Muslim conquest in 641 AD. The eastern part is shallow, and the western part is used for commercial shipping. The political situation in the Middle East was as chaotic then as it is now. In 1958, Iraq and Egypt had formed the short-lived United Arab Republic, which only lasted 3 years. Some idea of the confusion can be seen in our use of this courtesy flag with three stars, which had been adopted as the flag by Syria, and actually we should have been using one with only two, the choice of Egypt. As we take a panoramic view around this huge harbour, it's interesting to note that ships which had previously visited Israel were denied entry to the United Arab Republic, which resulted in the ridiculous situation that the Furnace Group had to maintain two fleets, one for trade with Israel and one for the Arabic countries. Strangely, this ban did not apply to the crews, who could serve on any ship without problems. Underwater exploration by archaeologists has turned up fascinating evidence of the city as it was before parts became inundated. Among the amazing discoveries were the site of Cleopatra's palace, the probable site of Mark Antony's residence, and the ancient royal harbour. Most of the finds will be left under the sea, having been mapped. This little map gives some idea of what was discovered there. So, back to ship's business, and a stay in port was the ideal time to paint overside. Here the deck cadets are preparing a stage for the purpose, which consisted of a plank of wood with spreaders to keep it away from the ship's side. Ropes, called falls, were used at each end to secure it and to allow it to be lowered. In this safety-conscious age, you may be astonished at the apparent cavalier attitude of the participants towards their own safety, both here and up the mast as you saw previously. However, safety was always in their own hands, and it was their responsibility to ensure that the equipment was in good order and that they used it properly. Accidents were actually very rare in consequence. Here you can see how the lowering was effected by easing the fall wrapped round each end. It was, of course, important to do this in unison in order to avoid an unexpected swim. Another very important task for the cadets would be to check the condition of the lifeboats, and especially their stores, and to change the water frequently. The port was, and of course still is, very busy, welcoming ships from all over the world. Our cargo contained mostly cars and tractors and textiles, although timber, tobacco, hardware and haberdashery were frequent items. Most of what we loaded for the UK consisted of agricultural products such as wool and rice, and gum arabic, which apparently has many uses, including as a stabiliser in food. Fresh dates were also a very popular cargo. Here we can see the royal yacht of the ex-King Farouk of Egypt, exiled in 1952. Having finished our stay here in Alex, we're now off to our next port, Beirut, in Lebanon. This will be another short trip, lasting about a day, and this time heading northeast, as you can see. Strangely enough, this little section often gave us some of the worst weather in the Mediterranean. The reason is that here, there are often high winds blowing from the north and creating a very rough sea. Since the distance across the Mediterranean at this point is relatively short, the waves created have a very short fetch, that is, the distance between the wave crests. Thus, unlike the waves in the open oceans, which have a long fetch, here the ship will rise on one wave and then smash into the top of the next one, instead of sliding down into the trough. This results in a condition known as pounding, which can cause severe damage to the bow plates and is extremely uncomfortable. For the skeptics among you, I can assure you that this film is not photoshopped in any way. Fortunately, on this trip, this rough sea is causing heavy rolling, not pounding, so we arrive safely and without any damage, and we can hoist the Cedar of Lebanon courtesy flag. After the First World War, Lebanon was governed by the French, prior to gaining its independence in 1943. Beirut is the capital of the country, and is one of the oldest cities in the world. Prior to the troubles in the region, it was a very beautiful city and a hugely popular destination for visitors. It became known as the Paris of the East. Unfortunately, in 1975, civil war broke out, and the city was largely destroyed. subsequent efforts at reconstruction have been hampered by frequent further outbreaks of violence, both internal and external, such as the war with Israel. However, for us, that is all in the future, as we enter the harbour, preparing the derricks as we go. As we manoeuvre towards our berth, we pass other moored ships, including this typical Mediterranean cruise liner of the period. Having turned around, we're going to be mooring on the Mole, port side or left side too. The Mole is one of the breakwaters protecting the harbour. The forecastle head crew are using the windlass, which also handles the anchors, and they're using it to tighten the head rope. Once tight, a small rope called a stopper is wrapped round it, and the tension can easily be maintained by one man while the rest quickly shift the rope to the bitts to make all fast. The bitts, of course, give rise to the phrase, to the bitter end. One of the advantages and joys of the time before containers arrived was that the length of time spent in port often allowed a run ashore. So we're off to see the sights. It's sobering to realise that nearly all of what we're seeing here would have been destroyed in the Troubles. Some sights, however, remain untouched, and the Pigeon Rocks are still one of the major attractions for modern visitors. Situated at the western edge of the city, these two rocks, one 70 metres 230 feet and the other 25 metres 82 feet in height, are believed to have been formed by a huge earthquake around 1202 AD. Nature then took over, forming this beautiful arch. We're heading south along the coast road with the sea to our right, past where the Beirut International Airport now stands. As we leave the sand behind and move more inland, the country becomes greener and fresher. And soon we're surrounded by the groves of citrus trees, which provide so much of our homeward cargo during the fruit season. Further still inland, we enter the beautiful valley of the Damour River, tumbling down from the mountains. As we drive along, the greens and browns of the hillsides provide us with such vivid and welcome contrasts to the usual blues and greys seen from our office, otherwise known as the ship's bridge. Sometimes, as a treat, we're given spectacular views down into the gorge. Continuing our journey, we're driving further into the mountains to visit the little town of Beit Adin, now administrative capital of the Shouf district, about 45 kilometres or 28 miles southeast of Beirut. Why here? Well, in 1811, the then ruler of this area, Emir Bashir II, moved his headquarters to the town. And what's your interest, you may say? Well, this actually, Beit Adin Palace. The Emir had started building this amazing complex in 1788, and he ruled his emirate from it. He even supplied water to it by building a lengthy canal from the Safia River. Since then, it has survived many occupations over the years, and was used by the French during their mandate, before being finally adopted as the Lebanese president's summer residence in 1943. It was undergoing restoration when I visited, but that didn't detract from its appeal in any way. Unfortunately, it was later badly damaged in the Civil War and the subsequent Troubles. However, in 1984, restoration began again, and now parts of the stunning buildings are open to the public, while the rest remains the summer residence of the president. The architecture is quite beautiful, and the intricate details are breathtaking. I'm so glad that so many of these beautiful palaces and houses are now open to the public all over the world for us to enjoy. We still have time to visit some more sites before we have to rejoin the ship. So we're now heading north, past Beirut, to visit the ancient town of Byblos, on the coast, some 37 kilometres or 23 miles north of Beirut. I believe that this huge complex was the campus of one of the famous universities of Beirut, which was also heavily damaged in the Troubles. Byblos town lays claim to being one of the oldest continuously inhabited towns in the world, having been settled since at least 5000 BC. Thanks to its yacht harbour, its beaches, its restaurants and its archaeology, it's become a favourite tourist destination in modern times. The archaeology suggests that the area appears to have been settled around 8000 years BC, even older than me. And since the first excavations in 1921, it's produced layer upon layer of fascinating artifacts and buildings covering every period since. As you can see, the Roman influence is very obvious. One of the main attractions among the ruins is this castle, built by the Crusaders in the 12th century and originally surrounded by a moat. It was captured by Saladin in 1188, and he had the walls dismantled. The Crusaders then recaptured and rebuilt it in 1197. I was amused to note that stone robbing is obviously not a new phenomenon, as is shown by these bits of Roman columns embedded in the walls. Altogether, I really enjoyed this visit, and found it very satisfying and interesting. However, as they say, time and tide waits for no man, and in our case the saying really does apply. So we must now make our way back to Beirut to rejoin the ship for the next part of our work. This is a good road as we head south again, so we make good time. Above us on the hillside looms this huge complex, which I believe is the Tamich Monastery. As we drive through the city, heading for the harbour, its popularity is immediately obvious, and you can see that traffic problems are by no means a modern scourge. As I mentioned previously, most of this beautiful city was destroyed in the Civil War. Such a shame. However, I am heartened to read that a new city has risen from the ashes and is now regaining its rightful place as a favoured destination. Now back in the harbour, the quickest way to get over to our ship is to catch a lift with one of the local boatmen. As he works his magic, we do get quite a nice view of our home. As we leave Beirut, you may be interested to know that my records show that amongst the cargo that we unloaded here were 1,000 cases of whiskey, which had been in the tween deck lockup. There were apparently also 9 concrete mixers, 11 cars, and a great many bundles of steel rods, presumably for building purposes. Since Beirut was one of my favourite ports, there was always a twinge of regret when leaving. However, there is more to be seen over the horizon, so on to our next port of call, Latakia in Syria, about 200 nautical miles north of Beirut. And after an uneventful run of around 13 hours, we arrive safely. Latakia is the principal port for Syria, and is also a manufacturing centre for the surrounding area, the city has, like the whole of the Middle East, been governed and controlled by a succession of rulers of different faiths and traditions over at least 2,000 years. It became part of independent Syria in 1936, once the French relinquished their mandate. Apart from some protest activity in 2011, it thankfully seems to have largely escaped the terrible conflict engulfing that country. One of our sister ships was also moored here when we arrived. From our point of view as visitors, it was a favourite place to buy beautiful silks and other fabrics for our loved ones at home. While the cargo work goes on, discharging and loading similar goods to the other ports that we visited so far, we can resume our work of beautifying the ship. This time it's the foremast that gets the attention. This mast and the surrounding area is easier to do in port, since at sea the whole forward part of the ship is affected by the spray of our passage. At least we're flying the correct courtesy flag this time. As you saw before, that most useful piece of equipment, the bosun's chair, is in use again. A paintbrush with a bent head, called a dogleg, is used for the awkward places. Hard-to-reach places overside also get the treatment, this time using a pontoon, but with an equal chance for a swim, if you're careless. It's a good job they have got their sea legs. The unused gangway is also pressed into service, while the cadets set about the wooden handrails on the bridge, sanding them down, ready for varnishing. We only made a short stop in Latakia, so an 8-hour run to Famagusta in Cyprus is next, where we shall also only stop briefly, this time to load some bales of cotton and sacks of carobs, which are apparently often ground down to make a replacement for chocolate powder. When we visited, tension between the Greek and Turkish Cypriots was very obvious. Famagusta was the only deep water port on the island at that time, and had developed into one of the world's best-known tourist and entertainment centres. The suburb of Furrosha, to the south of the port, became the hub. Following the Turkish invasion of the island, the Greek Cypriot population fled from Furrosha, and it's remained fenced off and frozen in time to this day, only visited by wildlife and vandals. Our visit to Cyprus also included a quick stop at Limassol to load further sacks of carobs. Since Limassol was only an anchorage then, we had to use lighters, as you can see here being towed astern. Unfortunately, the loading was done overnight, so I have no pictures of it. Incidentally, the word carrot, the indication for the purity of gold and gems, apparently takes its name indirectly from the Arabic word for carob. Our final destination before we head for home is Valletta in Malta. The westerly course takes us to the south of the island of Crete, before we turn to the northwest for the final run towards the island. It's a distance of around 900 miles. And at our average speed of roughly 13 knots, will take us about 3 days overall. Approaching the island, it's immediately obvious why it was of such importance to the Allies in World War II, and why the Germans tried so hard to subdue it, since it lies right in the middle of the seaway between the western and eastern Mediterranean. The Grand Harbour of Valletta has been of immense strategic importance to a succession of powers, stretching way back to the Phoenicians. As we reach the entrance to the Grand Harbour, its impressive fortifications are very obvious, and they were largely built by the Knights Hospitaller in the 16th century. Here we're passing the original walled city of Valletta on the western side of the entrance. Since our visit was before the island gained independence, the White Ensign still flew over Fort St. Elmo, marking the presence of the Grey Funnel Line, as the Royal Navy was affectionately known by merchant seamen. The fort is now open as the National War Museum of Malta. We will be mooring stern onto the jetty, using both our anchors at the bows to secure us and to help in hauling us off when leaving. From the battlements of the old city, we get a spectacular panoramic view over the harbour. This is the view looking down into Destroyer Alley, where the smaller naval ships moored. Passing another fort, we're looking over to the eastern side of the harbour. When I was editing this film, I was amused to find that I had unwittingly taken photographs of the Fleet Auxiliary supply ship Bacchus, which I was to join at a later date. Our view shifts to the south over the main town, and here is the ornamental gate through from the old walled city into the new. Shifting again and looking north, we get a lovely view of the harbour entrance. Fort St. Angelo comes into view, the upper part of which is now in the hands of the Sovereign Military Order of Malta, and finally we finish where we began, Destroyer Alley. The town is a fascinating place, if a little hilly, and I always enjoyed exploring it and elsewhere on the island. The streets are mostly rather narrow, which must make traffic a nightmare nowadays, and they were lined with fascinating shops, stocking a wide variety of goods. Given the ordeal that the Maltese people had undergone in World War II, I was also always struck by their friendliness and outgoing nature. Of course, more peaceful forms of transport were available. The principal working boat of the harbour was the Dicer, and their design can be traced back hundreds of years. They were so important to the work of the Royal Navy that in 1930 over 1,300 dicers were registered in the Grand Harbour alone, and many Navy ships actually kept their own on board. They always provided a different and fascinating view of the harbour. Sadly, when the Navy left in 1979, their working days were over. However, they now have a new lease of life as racing and leisure craft, and an annual regatta is held. The military presence meant that a large part of our cargo would be personal effects and NAFI stores, including spirits, as well as general cargo for the island, and it was discharged into lighters alongside. So, our duty done, as it were, it only remains to head for home and family. Although we're nice and calm inside the harbour, it does look somewhat choppy outside, and these pictures give you a really good view of a breakwater doing its job of protecting the haven. Before we shape our final course, there's just time for a last look back through the haze created by the spray, and we bid farewell to the island until the next time. The distance back to the Straits of Gibraltar is around 1,000 nautical miles, which will take about 3.5 days, weather permitting. As you can see, the crew's efforts have really been very successful, and the ship is looking very nice for our return. Also at this stage of the trip, a happy mood would pervade the ship, with thoughts of home and loved ones. The Mediterranean run was always interesting, with the ports changing with every trip, even occasionally including a run into the Black Sea to visit Romania and Bulgaria, both in the throes of the Cold War at that time. Our normal home in the UK was the West India Docks, under what is now Canary Wharf. But we would sail from any UK port if needed, and sometimes even from Antwerp or Rotterdam on the continent. As if to wish us bon voyage, we're joined by some of our favourite creatures, the dolphins. Their amazing skills are breathtaking, and the ship could never outrun them. I loved the sense of joyfulness that was always present, and I could watch them forever as they weaved effortlessly in and out of the bow wave, never pausing for a moment. We've again passed through the Gibraltar Straits at night, and we're back in the Atlantic. We can bring our film to a satisfactory end where we began, at Cape St. Vincent. This time the massive headland is on the starboard or right-hand side of the ship, which truly proves that we're heading north for home. All that now remains is for me to thank you for watching the film, and also to thank Google Earth for the lovely maps that we've used. And as the sun sets in the west, I really do hope that you've found it interesting.